Welcome everybody tonight. I'm going to be doing a quick sermon tonight on, or good morning. I'll be doing a sermon on a quick sermon called Love, and I believe that strongly this is from the heart, and this is what God is directing on me to say to you people. Love one another, just love one another as God has loved you. But I'm just going to quickly start off with this. There's a book I got, Spoken from the Heart, by Salwyn Hughes. And it says, includes a full-length recording of He's Just Carpenter's on CD. He's Just Carpenter on CD, as you see there. And he's talking about Jesus Christ was just a carpenter. So, and I'm just going to take out an extract out of that. And this is very interesting and very something from my heart. But it says here, no theologian. What is theologian? A theologian is somebody that looks at the theology. Looking at the theology of the history and the theology of the word of God, the Bible. But it says here, and he's been a preacher and a pastor for more than 50 years, over 50 years, this man here. And he's talking about no theologian, no matter how educated or reputable, can adequately explain why God loved us. I've been trying to explain it for decades. I've now given up trying to explain it, but I have not given up talking about it. So what he's saying is no theologian or nobody that does theology, no matter how educated or reputable, can adequately explain why God loves us. I've been trying to explain it for decades, and I have now given up on trying to explain it. But I've not given up talking about it. He hasn't given up talking about the love of God, the mercy of God, the grace of God. He hasn't given up talking about the love of God. He's just given up trying to explain what it means. I've not given up talking about it. I'll tell you, the greatest joy of my life is to stand up and preach about it. I think of no other subject more wonderful and no topic more thrilling. You see, to explain the love of God would require that He loves us for something outside of Himself, whilst the truth is, loves us for ourselves alone, that love has its fonts in depth of His own being. He chooses to love us just because He is love. Jesus Christ is love. God is love. And if you accept Jesus Christ in your heart, you can truly, truly understand He chooses to love us. That is such a great blessing. He chooses to love us. Amen. Hallelujah. Just because He loves. Jesus Christ is love. He loves us. And as he goes on to say, this man in this book here, and I'm just reading an extract from his book. And I would urge people, grab this book, read it. It's a great book. But this is what he says here. He says, you see, to explain the love of God would require that He loves us for something outside of Himself. Whilst the truth is, He loves us for ourselves alone. He loves each individual for themselves alone. That love has its fonts in depth of His own being. He chooses to love us just because He is love. The great hymn writer Charles Wesley begins one of his hymns with these words, He hath loved us, and often wonder to myself what it might have been in his mind as he pondered the next line. Would he try to give some reason for divine love? No, he is too wise to try to come up with that reason, as he knew full well there is no reason. So he wrote, He hath loved us, because he would love. He chose to, just because he loves. He is such a God, as other hymns has put it. It is love to the loveless shown, without reason and without love. He loves all of us. So I'm going to go further on to this. So I just thought I'd bring out that extract. But one thing that jumps out at me is that it says here, that love itself fonts in depth of his own and being. He chooses to love us just because he is love. So what my message is here is, no theologian, no matter how educated or reputable, can adequately explain why God loves us. And as he's saying, this pastor here is saying, I've been trying to explain it for decades. I have now given up trying to explain it, but I have not given up talking about it. He hasn't given up talking about the love of God. It's a very interesting book. Maybe you can get it. I'll just go into the Bible here in Romans 12. Romans 12, verses 1 through 2. Verses 2. Therefore I urge you, this is in relation to ourselves, in righteous practice application of service in relation to ourselves. Therefore I urge you, brothers, in the views of God, mercy to others, your bodies, as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is. His good, pleasing, and perfect will. It says there, therefore I urge you, brothers, in the view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. See, your spiritual act of worship, your spiritual act of worship. He's saying, therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in the views of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. What does that mean by offering your body as a living sacrifice? A holy and pleasing to God, this is your spiritual act of worship. So your spiritual act of worship is to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, to be holy, to be pleasing to God, be doing the will of God, to be doing the will of God and to listen to God, to pray, to read your Bible, to do the will of God, to walk as Jesus would have walked and to do the things that Jesus commands us to do, and offering your body as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. So for a spiritual act, not like, you know, as a human thing that we can actually see. So spiritually sometimes we can't see what it is, or spiritually we can't see what it is and we can't explain it, but spiritually it is happening in our lives. And really at the end of the day, we've got to accept and be pleasing in God's will, that we're willing to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the patterns of the world, but transformed by renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. His good and pleasing, perfect will. His good and pleasing, perfect will. Good and pleasing, perfect will is He loves us. And as I was reading in this book here, is that before, as I was reading, is how resentful of others love some. See, he says what I was reading here. Consider him love can be. See, as I was saying, and I think what I'll do is I'm going to leave it here. But I was reading from Romans 12. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in the view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the patterns of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. His good and pleasing, perfect will. His good and pleasing, perfect will. I will go to part 2 of this sermon of love.